Hello everyone, welcome to Avipedia. My name is Abhishek Sharma and today we have to discuss the relationship between monetary and fiscal policy, how they sometimes complement each other and how sometimes the personality issues or some kind of institutional lethargy tries to pitch them against each other. So anyhow, the interaction grounds between this monetary and fiscal policy can be understood by first understanding the movement of money within the economy. See, there are three essential systems that deal with movement of money within the economy. First system is the monetary system that has to deal with the flow of money. Second system is the financial system that needs to deal with the borrowing and lending of money. Third system is the fiscal system that deals with the receipts and expenditure of money by the government. Now, all these systems are operating within one economy, right? Now, all these together deal with the movement of money. Now, when they are interacting with each other, one more system comes into play, that is trade or external trade specifically. So import and export of the country. So when these systems are interacting within the economy, how your money gets affected, how economic growth gets affected, how inflation gets affected, all these are the major considerations that we have to think about. In UPSC, every year in prelims, there has to be a question on whether, why there is inflation, how to manage it, how to control it, certain tools of inflation, right? That is one area. Second, with respect to economic growth. So in mains, they always ask a question, for example, the investments are crucial for economic growth or savings are critical for economic growth. So we have to understand that something becomes critical for the economic growth based upon what is the situation of the economy right now. Now, as far as these three systems that we talked about, monetary, fiscal and financial, they interact with each other through this figure that we have drawn at the back. So let's try and understand this first. So imagine that capital M represents the total money in the economy. Now, agents of production within the economy, that is the primary, secondary and tertiary sectors, they will be producing goods and services, and this produced goods and services, essentially, if you remember GDP, now that is the national income that is produced within the economy. This income is consumed in various ways. One, in consumption expenditure. Two, in payment of taxes to the government. Three, in savings. Whatever the income is saved, it goes into something that we are here calling as PLT or private liquidity tank. This represents the cash money in your pocket. This represents your demand and time deposits within the banks. So essentially, this represents the financial system. Maybe the organized or the unorganized. So both these systems are there, and out of this system, investments take place within the economy that we have represented with I, that is private investment. Now, as far as your taxes were concerned, they went into the government budgetary tank that we have represented by GBT. I have not shown non-tax revenues because these are the revenues that will be generated by the government from those production activities only, or supply kind of some kind of goods and services, right? Okay, so out of GBT, government will also be spending money through its fiscal policy, whatever is the budget. Remember, it is the business of state to decide who gets what, when and where, and through the budget, this decision making is being done. So government expenditure happens into the economy. So you see, there are three basic kinds of expenditures which have just happened. One is government, second is consumer, third is the investor. Whenever these three are spending in the economy, the things that they want to spend upon won't be available domestically at all times. So some things need to be imported into the economy as well. Now, whenever you import, money flows out of your system into the external sector. Import exports, right? And whenever you export, the money flows back into your system. So this is how the money is moving in terms of import and export. Now, if you club all these kinds of demands, so to speak, the consumer demand, government demand, investor demand, export demand, and the import demand as well that is going out of your economy. So all these demands, if you put it into one equation, you get national expenditure is equal to C plus G plus I plus X minus M. Consumer expenditure, government expenditure, investment expenditure, export expenditure, and minus import revenues, because that's the money going out of your system. Now, if you think of this, GBT, this represents the fiscal policy. Now, the consideration which we are dealing with here are two, inflation and economic growth. Essentially, all these three systems, monetary, financial and fiscal are targeted at these two basic points or agendas in the economy. How is the economic growth? Is it inclusive enough? Is it sufficient? Is it happening everywhere? Is it sustainable? These are the agendas that are taken in consideration while making the fiscal policy. Now, how is the rate of inflation? How it can be managed? What is the amount of money supply within the economy? These are the things that are being taken into consideration largely in the monetary policy. Then, borrowing and lending of money from the excess areas to the deficit areas, the money intermediation is being carried out by the financial system. Now, all these systems sort of interact with each other in our economy and decide how the movement of money operates. Right? Now, so think of it this way, that the government in India wants to spend more money into the economy. So we know fiscal policy can be of three types. It can be balanced, surplus, or deficit. A balanced fiscal policy means that the government is going to spend what it earns. A deficit means it is going to spend more than that it is earning. Right? Surplus means it is going to spend less than what it has earned. So anyhow, in India, we generally talk about deficit budgets because government needs to spend a lot more. There are a lot of poor people, a lot of demographic dividend possibility, a lot of growth possibility. So therefore, the government goes on to spend more and more, as much as possible, while remaining within its resources. And that is guided by FRBM, something we'll talk about later. Now, for this deficit budget management, the government needs to borrow money. Essentially, if you want to spend more than what you earn, you have to borrow. Now, this borrowing can be either facilitated by the PLT, that is private liquidity tank, banks, yes, and the government can then pay back to the banks. Essentially, no new money gets added to the economy. And if you remember, inflation is a factor of money supply. There are monetary reasons for inflation. As you add more money to the economy, the demand is going to increase. So as the demand is going to increase, the prices are going to increase. There's a very simple correlation. Prices are directly proportional to demand over supply. So since here no new money gets added to the system, it's the same thing. Therefore, it is non-inflationary in nature. But since the government can get to spend the money, so therefore it will help in economic growth. In terms of money, if the government is not able to source sufficient amount of borrowing from PLT, then it can ask the RBI to put in money. This is something we call as deficit financing or monetization of deficit. So new money will now be supplied to the economy by the RBI to the government and then to the economy. This is like injecting fresh liquidity into the economy, that is cash money, and this liquidity ultimately will increase the demand and then take up the inflation. Now, whenever you come to this thinking that how these two are conflicting with each other, understand just this much. Whenever you are in the inflationary phase in the economy, little bit of inflation is good for economic growth. It's essential. But in Indian economy, we say 4% is the target rate with a range of plus minus 2%. This was the recommendation by Urjit Patel committee itself. Now, whenever it goes beyond that 6%, now monetary policy has to kick in. It has to make sure that the money supply within the economy is tight or dear. At this point, as we discussed in the previous video, the option with the RBI is to increase the rates and ratios and therefore ensure that there is lesser money available to the people. Which people? Right here, investor. So when they borrow money from the bank, they should be a little bit careful because rates and ratios have been increased. So that then this demand can come into control and then the prices can come into control. But now imagine another scenario that there is no economic growth happening in the country. The inflation rates are very low. Rather, we are moving towards deflation, means decreasing prices. Now in such a situation, fiscal policy becomes more active. Fiscal policy now will try to boost the economic growth process. And for this boost, it requires the RBI to lower down these rates and ratios, ensure that there is sufficient amount of liquidity in the system, sufficient amount of money supply, ensure that the demand goes up and therefore the prices go up and therefore the growth goes up. As you remember, something called law of supply. As the prices goes up, supplier would like to supply more and therefore the mutually reinforcing virtuous cycle that we talked about, that kicks in. Yes? Now, as far as the another scenario is concerned, the government's relationship, that is the fiscal policy and the monetary policy, both of them are basically using the financial system to ensure that there is sufficient amount of money supply in the system. Within this financial system, there are government banks, private banks, you know, all kinds of banks exist. So they will be helping in ensuring that the money supply is as thought out by the fiscal and monetary policy. This is where something called transmission of monetary policy becomes very important. That whatever benefit the RBI gives to the bank should transmit the benefit to the borrower. And so should be in the case of costs. Right. Now, moving on, as far as the fiscal policy and monetary policy of RBI are concerned, they are related in terms of debt and cash management as well. See, in the government budget, the estimates that are given by the government are sometimes related to over the year perspective. But maybe sometimes the government needs money right now and the cash has just not come in. So at that point of time, RBI has provided two kinds of facilities for the government, WMA and OMO. WMA means Ways and Means Advances System. In the Ways and Means Advances System, since it was launched in 1997, the RBI has provided an overdraft limit sort of a thing to government, in which the government, on the basis of the treasury bills that it deposits with the RBI, can withdraw money for 10 days and then put it back. It's a two-way accounting system and it will happen automatically. There is no such thing that government will take money and then just keep spending it and not return it. It will be automatically deducted from the government's account on the 11th day. Right. Now, second system is OMO. So if the government needs money for a long period of time, so that is open market operation, so the government can print short-term or long-term kind of securities based upon how much is the time for which it needs money. So maybe it is short-term security or it is 10-year security or whatever kind of the government bond that government wants to come up with. So those can be sold and bought by RBI through open market operations to anybody in the market, to the banks and so on. And that's how the government debt and cash management will go on with the RBI. One more correlation for government and RBI, therefore, or the monetary policy and fiscal policy, therefore, is the external sector. See, RBI is the manager of foreign exchange within the economy. So, as far as this external sector is concerned, for ensuring that there is a balance in the balance of payment of account, so anytime, if you have understood this external sector, there is a current account and a capital account. Both of these should be balanced to zero. In case there is an excess coming in, it should go into the RBI's foreign exchange reserves. In case there is a deficit, RBI has to put in money. So this management of money task is also taken care of by the RBI. So this is the correlation point between monetary, fiscal, as well as financial, as well as all kinds of systems which are happening in the economy. I hope you understood the all important aspect. This is very important for your UPSC. Ensure that you have a better understanding of this. In case you have any doubts with respect to this, you can call on to us or you can have my email ID, that is abhishek@abhimanyu.com, and pull in your questions whenever you need. Thank you so much for watching. Make sure you subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon so that you get all the notifications with respect to the new videos that are coming in. Thank you. All the best for your preparation.